Hello again. Welcome back. I'm your host, Andrew Gray. In the previous episode 1, we considered the emission of electromagnetic radiation. This episode is just the opposite. We will consider the absorption of electromagnetic radiation in this episode. And the best way to do this is by studying the absorption of light in the photoelectric effect. The photoelectric effect is the absorption of light by electrons that are then ejected out of a metal. Shine light onto a metal in a vacuum and see electrons being ejected. This is the photoelectric effect. The photoelectric experiment is the second key experiment that we will study in this series. You must understand how electrons absorb light in order to understand future episodes. So let's get started. This is New Wisdom Unifies Physics.
First, a brief history of the photoelectric experiment.
Heinrich Hertz, a German physicist, discovered the photoelectric effect in 1887. Hertz was experimenting with a wire ring that had a brass sphere and a point making a spark gap. He wanted current to spark across the gap when he generated radiation. Well, Hertz got his ring to spark. All right. But when he wanted to put his ring in the dark so he could better demonstrate the spark, lo and behold, the ring quit sparking. Hertz, using a prism, discovered that if his radiation had ultraviolet light in it, his spark started much easier. This effect, ultraviolet light making sparks jump across a gap easier, was initially called the Hertz effect. The Hertz effect was a type of photoelectric effect. Hertz was the first to see such a photoelectric effect with ultraviolet light. He really had no idea why the ultraviolet light made his spark easier, but he thoroughly documented it so others could continue with the study. In 1899, Joseph John Thomson, or J.J. Thomson for short, discovered the particles that are ejected during the photoelectric effect. He used a vacuum tube instead of an air gap. A vacuum tube helped Thomson identify the particles. Thomson found that the ejected particles were negatively charged and had a tiny mass, less than 1/1000th the mass of a hydrogen atom. So he called them corpuscles, meaning small bodies. His corpuscles would later be called electrons. In 1902, Philipp Lenard, who was Heinrich Hertz's assistant, discovered something very surprising about the photoelectric effect. He used arc lamps to shine extremely intense light onto the metal, only to find that increasing the intensity of the light did not make the electrons come out with more energy. He increased the intensity of the light as much as he could, only to find that the electrons did not come out with more kinetic energy. So, for example, Lenard used a prism to shine blue light onto the metal and measured the maximum kinetic energy of the ejected electrons. Now, not all electrons came out with the maximum kinetic energy, but Lenard was interested in the maximum kinetic energy. Then, Lenard made his arc lamp much more intense, like this. It was expected that the electrons would come out with much higher kinetic energy, but But Leonhardt found that they did not come out with more energy. The electrons came out with the same maximum kinetic energy as they did with the dimmer light. Making the light brighter did not make the electrons come out with more energy. All it did was make more electrons come out, but not more energetically. Next, Leonhardt made another surprising discovery. He found that the only thing that actually made the electrons come out with more kinetic energy was to change the color of the light. Changing the color of the light was the only way to make the electrons come out with more kinetic energy. Leonhardt found that making the light more violet made the energy of the ejected electrons increase. Making the light more violet made the maximum kinetic energy of the electrons increase. So, for example, Leonhardt used his prism to shine green light on the metal and measured the energy of the ejected electrons. They came out relatively slowly. Then again, using his prism, Leonhardt shined violet light onto the metal and found the electrons coming out with much more energy. Making the light more violet, or in other words, increasing the frequency of the light, was the only way to make the electrons come out with more energy. Making the light brighter did not. This indeed was very surprising to Leonhardt, and to many, many others too. So in 1916, stop the history for a moment. Leonhardt's results were so surprising that we need to take a moment to appreciate just how unbelievable they actually were. So let's do a simple analogy with marbles so you can see how surprised Leonhardt actually was. We're going to have a little fun for a moment to see how intensity and frequency eject some marbles. Okay, let's say I take a clear jar like this full of marbles with a hole in the top. Let's observe what happens when I shake it with low intensity but high frequency. So I rapidly shake the jar with low intensity and high frequency. Okay, as you can see, no marbles came out of the jar. This is just opposite of what Leonhardt found with electrons. Leonhardt found that with low intensity and high frequency, the electrons shot out of the metal like crazy. Very, very curious. Now, let's try it again. This time, I shake the jar with high intensity but low frequency. Okay, here's high intensity but low frequency. Okay. Here you can see the marbles came flying out. This is high intensity with low frequency with marbles. Again, this is just opposite of what Leonhardt found with electrons. When Leonhardt used high intensity with low frequency, no electrons came out at all, none. Intuition would tell you that if you used extremely high intensity, the electrons, like the marbles, would come flying out more energetically. But this is not what happened with Leonhardt. No electrons came out with extremely high intensity. This was actually very, very curious. So here is the crazy situation. Let's say we shake the marbles with low intensity and high frequency, like this. Okay, as before, no electrons came out. No marbles came out. But here is what Leonhardt saw when he did it. The electrons shot out of the metal like crazy when he shook them softly but with high frequency. This seemed crazy to Leonhardt. This is because it was expected that high intensity would eject the electrons, not high frequency. Making the frequency higher, even with very low intensity, made the electrons come out with higher energy. This was very, very curious and required explanation. This was so surprising that a man named Robert Millikan just did not believe it. So he had to do the photoelectric experiment to see for himself. So this is where we continue our photoelectric history. Leonhardt had shown that the maximum electron kinetic energy in the photoelectric effect varied with light frequency and not with light intensity. And in 1905, Einstein introduced his photoelectric theory compatible with Leonhardt's results. But Robert Millikan just could not believe it. So in 1916, Millikan performed the photoelectric experiment to see for himself. Millikan found that the maximum kinetic energy of the ejected electrons varies linearly with the light frequency. Millikan found that the maximum kinetic energy of the photoelectrons varies linearly with the light frequency. So, here are Millikan's 1916 results for light shined onto lithium. Isaac.
Yes, Andrew.
These results are hard to see, so morph Millikan's lithium results into something more easily viewable.
Okay, Andrew. You can now see Millikan's results better.
Okay, thanks, Isaac. You can now see from Millikan's data that the maximum kinetic energy of the ejected electrons varies linearly with light frequency. Here is what Millikan said in his 1916 paper. The energy with which an electron is thrown out of a metal by light is independent of the intensity of the light, while it depends on its frequency. This fact alone seems to demand some modification of classical theory. To Millikan, this was very curious and demanded explanation. And Millikan did not believe Einstein's theory. But Millikan grudgingly accepted the experimental results because, hey, they were his own results. But he was still very surprised. And not only that, in his same 1916 results, Millikan found that there was a threshold light frequency below which there were no electron ejections. Millikan found a threshold light frequency below which there were no electron ejections, no matter how high the intensity. Intuition had predicted that there would be a threshold intensity below which there would be no ejections. But instead, Millikan found there was a threshold frequency below which there were no electrons ejected, no matter how intense the light. So, for example, when Millikan used red light, no matter how bright, there were no electrons ejected. Then, when he used yellow light, there were still no electrons ejected. Then, when he used green light, the electrons barely were ejected. This was the threshold frequency for the lithium that he used. And any light with a lower frequency did not cause ejections. But any light with a higher frequency did cause electron ejections with more and more kinetic energy. These findings were contrary to the classical electron theory of his day, and Millikan only believed them after he saw them for himself. In 1931, Milton Chafee did a photoelectric experiment into a metal vapor instead of onto a metal plate. This eliminated the complexity of the metal surface. Chafee discovered that the electrons are ejected sideways, and the electrons are ejected along the polarization of the light wave. In other words, the electrons are ejected along the transverse electric force present in the light wave. The electrons are ejected along the transverse electric force present in the light wave. So take a look at the graphic. Ultraviolet light is incident from the left and goes through a chamber containing potassium vapor. we have shown the vertical electric force lines that move along with the ultraviolet wave. These forces oscillate up and down in the transverse direction. Electrons are ejected in the transverse direction along the electric force lines of the light wave, either up or down. Next, an ultraviolet wave with horizontal electric force lines is incident on the potassium vapor. In this case, the electrons are ejected horizontally along these horizontal electric force lines present in the UV wave. In both cases, we see the electrons are never ejected forward as predicted by the current theory. Others, including Emanuele Petersoli in 2005, found the same result from a metal solid. Petersoli found that electrons are ejected from copper along the polarization of the light wave. This confirmed Chafee's discovery. When Petersoli shined vertically polarized ultraviolet light onto the copper, many electrons were ejected from the copper. And these ejections were along the light wave's vertical polarization that was pointing out of the copper. On the other hand, when Petersoli shined horizontally polarized ultraviolet light onto the copper, almost no electrons were ejected. So, vertical polarization, many electron ejections. Horizontal polarization, almost no electron ejections. The Chafee and Petersoli results are very surprising to a modern day physicist. And actually, this sideways ejection along the light wave polarization is not compatible with Einstein's photoelectric theory. Let me emphasize this. The sideways ejection is not compatible with Einstein's photoelectric theory. Einstein's photoelectric theory with light particle absorption would predict a forward ejection, driving the electrons further into the metal. This is not what happens, so we need a new wisdom explanation. And again, let's get right to it. Here is the explanation for the photoelectric effect. In most physical systems where weak intensities can drive a system in a big way, there is usually some sort of resonance involved. A resonance can use a weak intensity to drive a system wild. For example, suppose that your daughter is swinging in a swing set. If you use your fingers to lightly push her every time she swings by, just a light touch can make her swing higher and higher. This light touch must be in resonance with her, though. And if you use more energy than friction, then she can swing as high as she wants to until it gets a little dangerous to continue. This is the lesson of resonance. A weak intensity in a resonance with oscillation can drive a system wild. So, we suspected that there's a resonance involved in the photoelectric effect since a weak light intensity can eject the electrons in a big way. And a resonance situation is exactly what we find in the photoelectric effect. Here is new wisdom for the photoelectric resonance. The photoelectric effect is indeed a resonance situation. Isaac.
Yes, Andrew.
Put up the photoelectric summary, please.
It's now showing.
Okay. Thanks, Isaac. So just imagine if an electron is pulsating in the metal and has a resonance with the incoming light. That is, imagine that the electron has its pulsation frequency equal to the light wave frequency. This would cause a resonance, an acceleration resonance, which would start the ejection. A light wave with the same frequency as the electron's pulsation would start an ejection. The electron would then accelerate, gaining kinetic energy, And from de Broglie, we know that when the electron's kinetic energy increases, its pulsation frequency also increases. So as the electron accelerates, it would increase its pulsation frequency. The limit would be up to twice the light wave frequency when there would be a non-acceleration resonance causing a kinetic energy limit. So, using de Broglie's formula from episode 1, the kinetic energy of the electron goes to approximately 1/2 h, which is Planck's constant, times twice the light wave frequency, or the maximum kinetic energy of the electron would go to approximately h times the light wave frequency. This famous energy relation for the absorption of light energy does not depend on intensity, only on frequency, which is surprising unless you consider it a resonance condition. So again, this is how the photoelectric effect works. The electron first resonates with the light wave, causing an acceleration resonance to start the ejection. The acceleration adds kinetic energy to the electron, so it increases its pulsation frequency. Then it has a non-acceleration resonance, which limits the absorption to approximately h times the frequency of the light. So this process basically has two resonances. First, an acceleration resonance, which starts the ejection. Then a non-acceleration resonance, which limits the kinetic energy. You must understand these two resonances in order to understand the photoelectric effect. So first, let's talk about the first step, the acceleration resonance. Okay, the acceleration resonance. Let's imagine a metal plate that has violet light incident onto it. The violet light penetrates the metal for many wavelengths. We have shown the electric force on the electron that travels along with the light wave. A conduction electron in the metal is fairly free, and it just so happens to be pulsating with the same frequency as the light. When the electron's electric field is on, it is accelerated much more than when its electric field is off, so the on parts of the cycle dominate the acceleration, and since the electron is on in sync with the up force of the light wave, the electron is accelerated upward along the electric force in the light wave. Isaac, announce what happens.
Upward acceleration, upward acceleration, upward acceleration, upward acceleration. Upward acceleration, upward acceleration, upward acceleration, upward acceleration.
Okay, in this case, the electron experiences mostly upward acceleration, especially while it's on. This makes the electron go upward. Of course, if the electron were on during the downward force of the light wave, the electron would be driven back further into the metal. Okay, I think you get the idea. Now we can show the non-acceleration resonance. This time, a conduction electron is pulsating at 2 times the light frequency. First, the electron's electric field is on with the up force of the light wave, then the electron is on during the down force of the light wave. Remember, when the electron's electric field is on, it's accelerated much more than when its electric field is off. So the on parts of the cycle dominate the acceleration, and since the electron is on in sync with both the up and the down forces of the light wave, the electron has no net acceleration at all. First, the electron is on with the up, then on with the down. So in this case, the average acceleration of the electron is 0, and the electron gains no more kinetic energy. This is a non-acceleration resonance. This is what limits the electron's kinetic energy. Isaac, announce what happens.
Acceleration up, down, up, down, up, down. Down, up, down, up, down, up, down.
Okay,
you can now see that the electron gains no more kinetic energy when the electron's pulsation frequency reaches twice the frequency of the light wave. Okay, let's quickly review these two resonances. First, the acceleration resonance. If the electron has its pulsation frequency equal to the light frequency, then one, the electron can be on in sync with the up force of the light wave. It can be on in sync with the up force of the light wave. Then two, the electron accelerates upward and gains kinetic energy. It accelerates upwards, gains kinetic energy, which starts the ejection. Okay, now compare that to the non-acceleration resonance. If the electron has its pulsation frequency equal to twice the light wave frequency, then one, the electron is on in sync with the up and the down forces of the light wave. It is on in sync with the up and the down forces of the light wave. Then, two, the electron has no net acceleration and gains no more kinetic energy. It has no net acceleration, which limits the kinetic energy.
Okay, now we can finally use these two resonances together to explain the photoelectric effect.
And in order to do this, we're going to have to ride along beside our electron down inside the metal so we can see both resonances in action. Okay then, let's go way down inside the metal just below the surface. And here comes the violet light wave which strikes our electron that just so happens to be pulsating at the same frequency of the light, an acceleration resonance. There it goes. It's accelerated upward and begins to pulsate more rapidly. Now we have random acceleration since the electron is not in sync with the light. Perhaps the electron gains kinetic energy. Now the electron pulsates at twice the frequency of the light, a non-acceleration resonance. If it has enough energy, it leaves the surface. Now the pulsation frequency is twice the frequency of the light, so its average acceleration is zero. It accelerates no more, so it gains no more kinetic energy. Then, according to de Broglie, the maximum kinetic energy is 1/2 h times twice the frequency of the light, or the maximum kinetic energy is approximately equal to h times the frequency of the light. This is the famous relation for the absorption of light energy, and notice that we've obtained it using only the wave nature of light. So let's run this simulation again. Here is the simulation again. Here's the metal plate, and here comes the violet light wave. It finds our electron pulsating at the same frequency as the light wave. This is the acceleration resonance. Let's pause the action right here. Do you remember the voltage kick that we gave an electron in episode 1? Do you remember? Well, let's bring that clip in from episode 1 to illustrate what will happen to an electron when it gets accelerated upwards. Here's that clip. Okay, so let's give this pulsating electron a kick with a voltage and watch de Broglie's formula in action. So, let's let the electron move slowly and pulsate slowly. It's moving slowly and pulsating slowly. But when we give it a voltage kick, it gains kinetic energy and it starts to pulsate rapidly. Let's try that again. Here's the electron. It moves slowly and pulsates slowly. The field turns on and off slowly. Now, let's give it a voltage kick and watch it gain kinetic energy and pulsate rapidly. To find out how rapidly, we just applied de Broglie's kinetic energy formula. So we've used this clip to emphasize that when the electric field in the violet wave kicks the electron upwards, it will start to pulsate more and more rapidly as it accelerates. Okay. Let's rejoin the action after the electron has been accelerated upwards and is pulsating more rapidly. Here we go. Now the electron's pulsation frequency speeds up, so we have random accelerations. Only some electrons will be randomly accelerated even more. Some electrons may even be decelerated, but some will be accelerated more. The next step will be to leave the metal surface if it has enough energy. The electron does lose some kinetic energy leaving the metal surface, but it can regain this kinetic energy outside the metal since the light wave's electric force still acts on it. The electron gains no more kinetic energy after its pulsation frequency reaches twice the light frequency. This allows the use of de Broglie's kinetic energy formula to get the approximate maximum kinetic energy of the electron. The approximate max kinetic energy electron turns out to be H times the frequency of the light. So we run the simulation one final time with simpler comments. Here is the violet light wave causing an acceleration resonance. Here are random accelerations and random pulsation frequency changes. Here the electron reaches a non-acceleration resonance inside the metal. The non-acceleration resonance might be obtained outside the metal. Here we apply de Broglie's kinetic energy formula to get the approximate max kinetic energy. Isaac, this is the basic explanation for the photoelectric effect. Do you have any questions?
Yes, Andrew. I have two questions.
What is your first question, Isaac?
My first question is, why do you say that the de Broglie relation is approximate for the photoelectric effect?
Okay, Isaac. Why is the de Broglie relation only approximate for the photoelectric effect? To answer this question, let's show a plot of de Broglie's kinetic energy relation. Here it is. In episode 1, we were in the range of 10,000 to 30,000 electron volts for the electron's kinetic energy. De Broglie's relation worked fine for this range, but now let's go looking much closer to the origin where the photoelectric effect is. The photoelectric effect is in the range of only 10 electron volts. Compare 10 electron volts in the photoelectric effect to, say, 20,000 electron volts in episode 1. 10 electron volts is much, much closer to the origin. So, let's zoom in on the origin. Isaac, zoom in on the graph. Okay, so the question is, can de Broglie's kinetic energy relation go through the origin? That is, can the pulsation frequency of the electron actually go to zero? Well, we have already seen that the electron's electric field cannot be static. A zero pulsation frequency would correspond to a static electron electric field. An electron with a static electric field, as we concluded in episode 1, is just not possible because of self-energy considerations. So the plot cannot go through zero. So the electron must actually have a small minimum pulsation frequency as its kinetic energy goes to zero. Call it F0. So we see that we must subtract this minimum pulsation frequency from de Broglie's relation so it does not go through zero. We get the following relation. The kinetic energy of the electron is approximately equal to 1/2 H times the electron pulsation frequency minus F0. This minimum frequency F0 has to be relatively small. Perhaps 1/2 H F0 is about 1 electron volt, perhaps. So let's change our graph and show this shifted de Broglie relation. Isaac, zoom in some more and put up this de Broglie shifted kinetic energy relation. Okay, we see from the plot that as the kinetic energy of the electron comes from zero, the electron's pulsation frequency comes from F naught. We do not know exactly where the intercept is, but we do know that it cannot go through zero. Okay, but this is still not the end of the photoelectric story. This shifted de Broglie relation would only apply to a free electron that has been linearly accelerated. But the photoelectric effect is only approximately a free electron being linearly accelerated. There is one more thing to consider here. The conduction electrons in a metal are not quite free. They are loosely bound to the atoms in the lattice and are pulsating differently because of the atomic centripetal forces on the electrons. When the electrons come off the atoms, they do not exactly follow de Broglie's linear formula because they come from circular orbits. They have some other starting frequency besides F naught. So we make one more addition to de Broglie's kinetic energy formula for the photoelectric effect to reflect the complete starting frequency due to all initial conditions. Like this. The kinetic energy of the electron equals 1/2 h times the pulsation frequency of the electron minus 2f submetal, where 2f submetal is twice the threshold light frequency for the metal. This 2f submetal term includes f naught plus the effects of the atomic accelerations from the metallic atoms. So the threshold frequency F metal will be different for different metals. So, for example, for sodium, we use Robert Millikan's photoelectric data, which gives a threshold frequency of about 450 terahertz. So twice this gives twice F sodium being about 900 terahertz. Isaac, overlay the sodium photoelectric data, please. We see that the maximum kinetic energy equals 1/2 h times the pulsation frequency of the electron minus 2f subsodium, where f subsodium is the threshold frequency for sodium. Now we bring the light back in. Remember, we have the pulsation frequency of the electron equals twice the light frequency when we have the maximum kinetic energy of the ejected electrons at their kinetic energy limit. So we again substitute twice the light frequency for the pulsation frequency, and we get simply that the maximum kinetic energy of the electron is h times the light frequency minus f subsodium. This is the famous photoelectric equation, and again, we stress that we have considered only the wave nature of light. Now, the F subsodium threshold light frequency would obviously be different, for example, for copper. So for copper, we can do the exact same analysis using copper's threshold light frequency, F sub copper. Isaac, overlay the copper photoelectric plot, please. Okay, here we see a similar plot for copper, but we have used F sub copper instead. So for copper, the maximum kinetic energy equals H times the light frequency minus F sub copper. Other metals will be similar. I think you get the idea. Each different metal will have a different threshold frequency depending on how bound the conduction electrons of the metal are. Notice here that nothing has to do with the kinetic energy lost at the metal surface. This is because the electron can regain any kinetic energy lost at the surface since the light still acts outside the metal. This is different from Einstein's photoelectric theory. In Einstein's theory, the light gives the electron a certain amount of energy one time, and that's it. In this new theory, the electron gains, over time, enough energy to escape from the metal surface, and then it can continue to absorb light energy outside the metal surface to reach its maximum kinetic energy. Not only that, this new theory is in agreement with photoelectric experiments and actually agrees with the electron ejections along the polarization of the light wave. Einstein's theory does not and does not agree. Isaac, does this answer your first question?
Yes, Andrew, it does.
Okay, Isaac, what is your second question then?
My second question is, I still do not understand why Einstein's photoelectric theory does not agree with the electron ejections along the light polarization. What is the reason for this?
Okay, Isaac. Why doesn't Einstein's theory agree with ejections along the light wave polarization? We'll dig a little deeper into this. Do you want to have a little fun?
Yes, Andrew. I have a new neural net, trained for fun. Can we try it out?
Okay, Isaac, let's try out your fun neural net. Remember, Einstein's photoelectric theory uses light particles. Light particles, which are supposedly absorbed by electrons, knocking them out of the metal. Let's see if it makes sense for the electrons to be ejected sideways by a particle absorption. So, Isaac, let's pretend that I'm an electron. I'm an electron inside the metal. And let's pretend that you will throw a particle at me, say a medicine ball particle. Okay, now rotate me around and put me into the metal like the other electrons. Okay, very good. Isaac, are you ready to throw that medicine ball particle at me?
Yes, Andrew. I have the medicine ball particle ready.
Okay, Isaac, throw it. Oof. Okay, Isaac, throw another one. Oof. Isaac, did you see that when I absorbed the medicine ball particle, I was driven deeper into the metal along the same direction that the medicine ball particle was traveling? I absorbed the particle and was driven deeper into the metal. I did not go flying upwards out of the metal. Isaac, get ready. Imagine that I absorb the medicine ball particle and I go flying out of the metal, like this. Oof. Now this just does not make sense. I would not absorb the medicine ball particle and then shoot upwards like this. If I absorb the medicine ball and then shot upwards, that would be a little silly. Well, that is the same silly that we see in Einstein's theory. Isaac, throw another one. Oof. Just like this, Einstein's theory would predict electrons being pushed deeper into the metal and not up and out. If an electron did absorb a supposed light particle, it would tend to drive the electron deeper into the metal. But this is not what photoelectric experiments show. They show ejections that way, not that way, like Einstein predicts. So Einstein's theory does not agree with the experiments. Isaac, rotate me back around, please. Okay, thanks, Isaac. Does this answer your second question? And was it fun?
Yes, Andrew. I see why Einstein's theory doesn't agree. but I see no fun in this. Everything seems quite serious to me. Now I want to know why we keep Einstein's photoelectric theory at all. Why don't we just throw it out?
Now hold your horses, Isaac. You are getting ahead of the story here. Any theory vying to replace Einstein's photoelectric theory will have to stand the test of time and the scrutiny of critics. We intend to discuss what to do in this regard in later episodes, so hold your horses. Okay, now we want to get back to the real story. We want to rerun our photoelectric simulation with all the new information in mind. So, Isaac, rerun our photoelectric simulation, please. So here's our metal lattice, and perhaps a conduction electron is slightly bound to an atom. Then the conduction electron may get bumped off the atom by random forces, and then it has an acceleration resonance. There it goes. So let's follow along. The electron has been accelerated, so now its pulsations are a little faster, so the electron has random accelerations here. But perhaps the random accelerations cause the electron to go even faster and start pulsating at twice the light frequency. This is when the electron experiences a non-acceleration resonance. Next, the electron goes through the surface where it could lose a small amount of kinetic energy. However, it can regain this kinetic energy outside the metal since the light still interacts with it. And since the electron's average acceleration is zero, it gains no more kinetic energy. Now we can use our modified de Broglie formula to get the kinetic energy. It gives the maximum kinetic energy of the electron equals h times the frequency of the light minus the threshold frequency for the metal. This is the famous formula for the absorption of light in the photoelectric effect. And notice that we've only used the concept of light as a wave. We make waves through the understanding of the photoelectric effect.
We are almost finished with episode 2, but first we want to discuss what we have learned. Number 1. We learn that the photoelectric effect must be some sort of resonance since weak light intensity causes big ejections. This only happens with resonances. So the photoelectric effect is really a photoelectric resonance. And 2, we learned about the 2 resonances in the photoelectric effect. First, an acceleration resonance when the electron's pulsation frequency is the same as the light wave frequency, which starts the ejection. Then, a non-acceleration resonance when the electron's pulsation frequency reaches twice the light wave frequency, which limits the electron's kinetic energy. So, number 3, we can now understand why increasing the light wave intensity does not increase the electron's kinetic energy. This is because the ejection has a natural kinetic energy limit. So even though the intensity goes up, the kinetic energy limit stays the same. So increasing the light intensity does not increase the electron's kinetic energy. And 4, we can also understand why vertically polarized light ejects electrons from copper, but horizontally polarized light does not. With this new wisdom theory, this is fairly obvious. The electrons tend to be ejected along the electric force lines that travel with the light wave. When the electric forces are oriented along the copper surface with horizontal polarization, the electrons tend to be driven along the surface and not to be ejected. But when the electric forces point out of the copper surface with vertical polarization, electrons are ejected. Theories using light particles just cannot explain this fact and are erroneous.
Light particle theories are erroneous. And 5, we obtain the photoelectric equation by modifying de Broglie's kinetic energy relation to take into account the metal atoms' binding effects. We got that. The maximum kinetic energy of the electron equals Planck's constant times the light frequency minus the threshold frequency for the metal. The threshold frequency comes about because the electrons are loosely bound to the metal atoms, and de Broglie's linear kinetic energy formula does not quite apply because of the electrons' circular orbits. And finally, 6, the big picture. Isaac, put up the big picture. The big picture is the pulsating nature of the electron is what explains the photoelectric effect. Light waves interacting with pulsating electrons is what explains the photoelectric effect. This is the takeaway from episode 2. And this concludes new wisdom for the photoelectric effect. Coming up in episode 3, we explore new wisdom inside the atom. Get ready for episode 3. This is New Wisdom Unifies Physics. Isaac, wrap us out.
We're gonna take this new wisdom. We're gonna use it to see the atom. We're gonna see the electrons go round. We're gonna find out what it's all about. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We're gonna take this new wisdom. We're gonna use it to see the atom. We're gonna see the electrons go round. We're gonna find out what it's all about. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We're gonna take this new wisdom. We're gonna use it to see the atom. We're gonna see the electrons go round. We're gonna find out what it's all about. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We're gonna take this new wisdom. We're gonna use it to see the atom. We're gonna see the electrons go round. We're gonna find out what it's all about. Yeah, yeah, yeah.